questions. So I'll call on Roland to talk for us.
I'll have to start with an apology, which is that I got halfway here and realised I'd left my notes at home, so I'm partly flying by instinct and partly by old notes. But for the past 3 years at least, there's been a huge tornado of attacks and accusations, allegations of anti-Semitism directed mainly at members of the Labour Party, in particular Jeremy Corbyn and anybody close to Jeremy Corbyn. And unfortunately, for the past 3 years, I had to speak at so many meetings and write so much about this, and I'm concerned that it is actually deflecting attention away from Palestine and what's actually happening on the ground in Palestine. But I want to clear up some of the confusions and the myths, because I think there's a lot of deliberate and unconscious confusion and complications going on here. Anti-Semitism and Zionism are both misunderstood terms. They're both misunderstood and misused. They're misunderstood and misused. To start with, the term anti-Semitism is a very problematic term, because if I say I'm anti-racist, people know what it is that I'm against. If I say I'm anti-austerity, it's obvious I'm opposing austerity. But anti-Semitism, what's anti-Semitism opposing? What is this Semitism that anti-Semitism is opposing? The first thing you have to understand is that anti-Semitism is a term that was invented by 19th century European racists, European Jew haters, to give a pseudo-scientific gloss to their hatred of Jews and to their opposition to Jewish emancipation. They posited this quality, Semitism, that Jews carry within us, that it was their task as European traditionalist conservative Christians to oppose. The term has since been adopted widely, but we have to remember that Semitic actually is a linguistic term. You hear all these things. Arabs are Semites too, or Jews aren't really Semites, they're actually East Europeans, or even Jews aren't even a race, as though that means that there can't be racism against Jews. Well, for a start, I'd have to say, I don't think there is such a thing as race, objectively, it's a social construct. But beyond that, as I say, anti-Semitism was an invented term, took a term from linguistics and applied it just to Jews. When Wilhelm Marr set up the League of Anti-Semites, he wasn't opposing Islam or Muslims in Europe, he was opposing Jews. The term has come to mean opposition to Jews. It's not a perfect term, but that was the origins of the term. There's been, over the past few years, attempts to define and to categorise anti-Semitism and attempts to legislate against it. And there have been attacks on, I mean, just to go through some of the, within the Labour Party there have been, for instance, numerous attacks on Naz Shah, on Jackie Walker, on Ken Livingstone, on Mark Wordsworth. Many people who are not Jew haters but have committed the crime of opposing Israel beyond the bounds permitted by Zionist discourse. And there has been an attempt to codify this and to introduce it into law. One of the most effective attempts has been something that is now referred to as the International Holocaust Remembrance Association's definition of anti-Semitism. What this document is, it originated in a document submitted to an EU working party and then abandoned. And it starts with, I can find it, it starts with a very innocuous definition of anti-Semitism, which I can't find now, of course. But then it goes on to say, that this, their definition is, anti-Semitism is a certain perception of Jews which may be expressed as hatred towards Jews. Rhetorical and physical manifestations of anti-Semitism are directed toward Jewish and non-Jewish individuals and or their property, toward Jewish community institutions and religious faculty facilities. It actually is almost meaningless. But what they have then done is tacked onto it a list of 11 examples, seven of which are actually examples of opposition to Israel. So the articles include drawing comparisons of contemporary Israeli policy to that of the Nazis, denying the Jewish people the right to self-determination, e.g. by claiming that the existence of a state of Israel is a racist endeavour, accusing Jewish citizens of being more loyal to Israel or to the alleged priorities of Jews worldwide than the interests of their own nations, as if anybody has their own nation, holding Jews collectively responsible for the actions of the state of Israel. In fact, the last one is particularly interesting because that is what Israel does all the time. It claims to speak in the name of all Jews, so it is, by implication, holding us responsible for the actions of the state of Israel. Now, interestingly, this document has been adopted by the Labour Party, by the Conservative Party. The Labour Party adopted the document without the 11 examples. The Conservative Party has adopted it. Various local authorities have adopted it. I don't know whether Birmingham has, but various others have. And it's being used, and various universities have, and it is being used to prevent discussion of Middle East affairs, discussion of Israel, discussion of Zionism. Interestingly, there was a letter in, I don't remember where it was, in the Times of Israel last week, an article by the person who wrote the definition originally, who said, Kenneth Stern from the American Jewish Committee, who says, this definition was intended as an aid to European data collectors. It was never intended to police political discussion on campus. Mm-hmm. So what has happened here is that something that was developed as a tool for people monitoring anti-Semitic incidents, irrespective of the fact that I think it's insufficient and inappropriate, but a tool that was intended to assist data gatherers is now being used to actually prevent free speech. Some examples, for instance, I mentioned Naz Shah. Naz Shah is a Labour MP for Bradford West. She posted a picture on Facebook, which she actually took from Norman Finkelstein's Facebook page. Norman Finkelstein is a Jewish academic in New York, supporter of Palestinian rights. It was a picture of a to-scale map of Israel in the centre of the United States, basically saying that the conflict would be resolved if Israel was resettled in the United States. I mean, it was a flippant comment. It was in no sense anti-Semitic, but basically she was accused of wanting to deport all Jews from Israel. She was also accused, she posted something on Facebook. There was a survey during one of Israel's attacks on Gaza, a survey in the Daily Mirror on who do you blame, Israel or the Palestinians. And she posted something on Facebook saying, please go and vote on this. The Jews are mobilising. In fact, if you look at the Board of Deputies of British Jews, the recognised spokesperson for the Jewish community, if you look at their logbook, not their logbook, their report of activities for that period, they point out that at that time they had written to every synagogue in the country asking them to get members of the synagogues to take part in this poll. So, in fact, it wasn't even untrue. It was not Israel mobilising, but the Jewish community was mobilising to swing this poll. Basically, Naz Shah was suspended from the Labour Party, made an abject apology, and was reinstated. I'm pleased to note, though, that in following the latest Israeli attacks in Gaza, an early day motion signed by too few MPs, only a couple of dozen, but Naz Shah was one of the MPs who signed it, so they haven't fully succeeded in intimidating her. Ken Livingstone made a statement in support of Naz Shah. He was then hijacked, waylaid by John Mann. John Mann, you may know him, vicious anti-Corbyn MP, who's also been investigated by the police for his own racism. He wrote a booklet for Bassetville Council, where he's the MP, on how to remove gypsies from traveller sites. And it's been referred to the Racial Equality Commission. But anyway, he waylaid Livingstone and provoked him into making some, I think, intemperate remarks, where he made a couple of factual mistakes on historical questions. But this was then spun completely out of control. Livingstone is an anti-Semite. Nonsense. Ken Livingstone, and many of us, I mean, as people who have run the GLC in the 80s will know, Ken Livingstone is very, very far from an anti-Semite. He made some intemperate remarks, which he then explained later, and if you read his written explanation of them, just watch the interview where he was waylaid by John Mann. Because he was making a legitimate political point. You might disagree with it, but again, this was in no sense anti-Semitic. Jackie Walker is a black Jewish woman. She was vice chair of Momentum. She's a long-term anti-racist and anti-fascist activist. Basically, I don't know if anybody has seen her one-woman show, The Lynching. If you haven't, if you get a chance to, it's been travelling the country internationally, if you get a chance to see it, it's brilliant. But she tells the story there. Her father was a New York Jew. Her mother was, forget where, but from the Caribbean, and partly of Sephardi Jewish ancestry. In the course of a discussion on slavery, she basically said, my ancestors were involved in this on both sides, and that the Dutch Jewish community were among the sponsors, the funders of the Caribbean slave trade. This game was then spun out of control. Jackie Walker says Jews were behind the slave trade. Again, missing all the nuances. For a start, she didn't say were behind it. She said they were among the financiers of it. Second, she was not talking about the huge cotton slave trade in the United States, but about the sugar slave trade in the Caribbean. And she went on to say, look, that's why there are so many synagogues across the Caribbean, because Dutch and Portuguese Jews came over as merchants. And she was making the point that this is part of my history on both sides, and that our history and our politics are what we make of our heritage rather than imposed on us. Again, this is spun out of control. Jackie Walker is still waiting to hear whether or not she'll be expelled from the Labour Party. There's countless more examples. Mark Wadsworth, a long-term, very respected black activist who got into a confrontation at the launch of the Chakrabarty report, got into a confrontation with Ruth Smith, MP for Rugby, Derby, somewhere in there. I forget. But again, nothing he said. I don't know whether it's even worth going into all the details of all of these, because nothing he said was anti-Semitic. But again, it was spun out of control to suggest that this man was a vicious racist when he happened to disagree with someone who he didn't even know was Jewish. We've seen it used against many Jewish activists in the Labour Party. Moshe Machover, a highly respected Israeli academic, one of the founders of Matzpin, the Israel Socialist Organization, in 1961, which was the first anti-Zionist organisation in the state of Israel. He was briefly suspended from the Labour Party before being reinstated. Glyn Secker, the secretary of Jewish Voice for Labour, who was again briefly suspended from the Labour Party for anti-Semitism and then reinstated. Tony Greenstein, a long-term anti-fascist, anti-Zionist activist in Brighton, who was expelled from the Labour Party. Although people have been told he was expelled for anti-Semitism, they dropped the charges. And in fact, all of the people who have been expelled for alleged anti-Semitism, the charges of anti-Semitism have been dropped before the hearings. And Tony was expelled for inappropriate behaviour and rudeness. Mark was expelled, I think, for bringing the party... No, Ken was expelled for bringing the party into disrepute. I forget why Mark was expelled. But basically, what's happened is that a lot of shit has been thrown. People have heard, look, these people are dreadful anti-Semites. We've got to get rid of them. And then quietly, they've been expelled for other reasons. So, what we're seeing is a massive attempt, using this flawed definition of anti-Semitism, to delegitimize opposition to the state of Israel. There is, and it's going to be released very soon, but there is an alternative definition which is being promoted by Jewish Voice for Labour and Free Speech on Israel. It was mentioned in a letter in The Guardian last week by many leading cultural and academic figures. But basically, our definition will say, anti-Semitism is a form of racism, hatred, hostility, discrimination or prejudice against Jews because they're Jews. It may be manifested in violence, denial of rights, direct, indirect or institutional discrimination, prejudice-based behaviour or verbal or written statements. Such manifestations draw on stereotypes, characteristics which all Jews are presumed to share. Now, I think the important part of this is the very first sentence, anti-Semitism is a form of racism. Because what we've seen is an attempt to suggest that anti-Semitism is something other than racism. And not only does it not give us any material with which to combat it, to me, it actually throws it back. Anti-Semitism is something to do with Jews. I always insist, actually, anti-Semitism is nothing to do with Jews. It's to do with the racists. You combat it by understanding racism, not by understanding Jews. And then, we don't give examples, but we go into some explanations of the terms. And in particular, we repeatedly make the point that criticism of Israel is not anti-Semitic unless motivated by hatred of Jews. Opposition to Zionism is not anti-Semitic unless motivated by hatred of Jews. Because it's very clear there are people, we've come across them, we've all come across them, I'm sure, people who dislike Israel not because it's a colonial settler state oppressing Muslims, and of course many Palestinians are Christian as well, but there are people who dislike it because it's Jews doing it. So the first thing, that anti-Semitism is a form of racism and we combat it, and the reason that anti-Semitism is rising, if it is rising across Europe and across the world now, is because of a general right-wing climate across the world. It's linked to the rise of Viktor Orban in Hungary, to the right in Italy, to the right in Greece, and of course also to the rise of Trump and to the whole campaign, the whole wave of xenophobia unleashed by the Brexit campaign. That's the context in which any racism towards Jews has developed, and it's exacerbated by the policies of the State of Israel. Because, of course, what's happened is, on one hand, people were desperate to attack Corbyn. The Labour right were desperate to attack Corbyn because he's taken them out of the comfort zone. And there's the State of Israel that is, for a start, has been losing the propaganda campaign because they can no longer justify what's going on in Gaza. And they're increasingly losing young Jews, the young generation, a very large proportion of young Jews in the United States now explicitly does not identify with Israel. They've lost the propaganda argument, but where they can win is by saying, look, you're doing this because you don't like Jews. And seeing Corbyn as a Labour leader who's consistently supported Palestinian rights, of course, worries them. At the weekend in London, there was a large demonstration against Brexit. One of the chants from some of the protesters was, where's Jeremy Corbyn? In fact, Jeremy Corbyn was at a Palestinian refugee camp in Jordan at the time, meeting Palestinians, because he's been a consistent supporter of Palestinian rights. The other complete, often misunderstood term is Zionism. Zionism is thrown around as a catch-all phrase. I think it's thrown around far too widely at times. All sorts of things that people don't like. Zionism. No, Zionism is a political movement. Zionism is an organisation. There is an organisation called the World Zionist Organisation, which is based in the United States, but has quasi-governmental powers in the State of Israel. It has powers over land ownership and land distribution, over 94% of the land in the State of Israel is either owned or controlled by the World Zionist Organisation. And increasing proportions of land in the occupied West Bank, Gaza Strip, Jerusalem, and Golan Heights, also controlled by them. This is a body that's not answerable to the citizens of the State of Israel, not even answerable to the Jewish citizens of the State of Israel. It's answerable to what it defines as the world Jewish community. Many synagogues belong to the World Zionist Organization. Many political bodies belong to the World Zionist Organization. There are Zionist organizations and groups around the world. Many of them, in fact, recognized as charities, like the Keren Kayemet Jewish National Fund, that receive tax concessions, that are part of the World Zionist Organization, which is a real organization that has real power in the State of Israel. Now, when I say I'm an anti-Zionist, I don't mean Zionism is a catchphrase for I don't like Jews. Not at all. It means I am absolutely against the existence of this quasi-state body, which is not based in or answerable to people in the State of Israel, that has a constitution that says that its land, the land it owns, is for the benefit of people of Jewish race, religion, or origin, that controls over 90% of the land by law in the State of Israel, and which is therefore directly responsible for the dispossession of the Palestinian people and the theft of their land. That, to me, is what Zionism is and is about, and that's why I think it has to be opposed as part of any just settlement, and any settlement that's not just is not going to be lasting in the Middle East. Now, there have been many attempts to conflate Zionism and Jews. One of them, which Chris will remember, in fact, was the occasion when we met back in 1983. It was the anniversary of Sabra and Shatila, the massacre of Palestinians in refugee camps in Beirut. We had a rally in London, and members of the National Front came along to the rally with leaflets attacking Jewish war crimes in Palestine and Zionist financial criminals in London. So they were quite deliberately conflating the two and saying that Israel's crimes were committed because they were Jews, and that people in London who committed crimes were doing so because they were Zionists. A couple of us, executive members of Palestine Solidarity, went over, confronted them, took their leaflets, ripped them up and put them in the bin. As a result, I got punched. The police turned up, told the fascists to get lost, and arrested me. There's a long story here, but I mean, Chris was there and will remember it. But it was an attempt to conflate Zionism and Jews in order to increase hatred against Jews. Now, I would say that, unfortunately, the State of Israel deliberately fosters and encourages this. A number of examples. After the attack on a Jewish supermarket in Paris a few years ago, which I would argue was an anti-Semitic attack, and I understand the background and whatever, this was an anti-Semitic attack carried out on people who were Jews because they were Jews, not on people who supported Israel because they supported Israel. But after this attack, Netanyahu, the Israeli Prime Minister, went to Paris, took part in a big demonstration, and said to French Jews, now you see, it's unsafe for you to live here, come home to Israel. Another example, a notorious example, was the story of the Jewish community in Iraq. There'd been a very, very large Jewish community in Iraq, very well integrated into society for hundreds, thousands of years. They were the intellectuals, the merchants. A large part of the Communist Party of Iraq was Jewish as well. In the early 50s, they showed no signs of wanting to leave Iraq and go to Israel. There were a number of bomb explosions in Jewish community centres and synagogues in Baghdad. At the same time, Iraq at the time was virtually a British colony, and the government, under British pressure, introduced laws confiscating Jewish property. At the same time, there were bomb explosions in Jewish community centres, and most of the community fled to Israel, where they were treated very much as second-class citizens. So it's not as bad as Palestinians, but not as well as Jews from Eastern Europe. It turned out later that the bombs were planted by people sent over from Israel, by Israeli agents, by the Mossad, in an attempt to create the impression of anti-Semitism. One more example I'll give, and this is really shocking. A cartoon a few months ago, Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu's son, Yair Netanyahu, retweeted a cartoon, classic anti-Semitic cartoon, of Soros, George Soros, the Hungarian financier, depicted as typically Jewish, sitting there pulling the strings of the bankers and of the left and whatever. But this was typically something that could have come from the Nazi paper Der Stürmer, a typically anti-Semitic cartoon published by Netanyahu's son, because basically these people they agree with the European rights denunciations of Soros, and they'll use anti-Semitic stereotypes to reinforce this. It's no accident that when the EDL demonstrates, or now whatever they call themselves, the Football Lads Alliance demonstrates, there are plenty of Israeli flags on their demonstrations, because these people, basically, I would say they share the aim of the Israeli state. They don't want Jews here, they want Jews out there and in Palestine. There's always been a link between Zionism and anti-Semitism. Last year was the 100th anniversary of the Balfour Declaration, the British statement in 1917 that gave political clout to the Zionist movement. Balfour was recognised as a hero in the Israeli state. There's roads named after him all over the country. Some years earlier, in 1905, he was Prime Minister when Jews were fleeing pogroms in Eastern Europe. He introduced the first Aliens Act in Britain, designed to stop Jews coming into Britain who were fleeing persecution. His speech in the House of Commons was a classic of anti-Semitic. I've got it here somewhere, but you know, people who colour and mingle only with their own sort, only marry among their own sort. It's a threat to our women, a threat to our culture, a threat to our land. The sort of things that you hear now about Muslims as well. But basically, he didn't want Jews coming here. And so later he took the opportunity to promote the Zionist movement. In effect, what Zionism is and what the Balfour Declaration represented was an attempt by Europeans to resolve their Jewish problem by dispossessing the Palestinians. And everything we have seen in the past 3 years, the whole, in many cases, in most cases I'd argue, artificial anti-Semitism campaign has been designed to obscure the truth of this, to prevent people recognising the struggle in Palestine as a struggle of an oppressed and dispossessed people against a colonial settler society, to prevent people from drawing the very legitimate conclusion that Israel is an apartheid society and that the struggle of the Palestinians is similar to the struggle of the people of South Africa against apartheid, and instead focus attention on, look, we poor Jews, you Europeans have got no right to anything, you persecuted us for generations, and now you're doing it again by persecuting what this is, the one Jewish state in the world. This, I think we have to wise up and say, no, we're not going to let them deflect us from support for Palestinian rights by these spurious arguments. That means, for start, recognising that they're spurious. The other side of this, I would say, is that it means recognising in those instances where there are anti-Semites in the Solidarity Movement, and there have been, and some of us, my organisation, Jews Against Zionism, was very prominent in exposing Israel Shachar, Paul Eisen, Gilad Atzmon, and others who were trying to hijack the Solidarity Movement for nefarious purposes. When there are these individuals, yes, we have to expose them, we have to oppose them. We have to do this as part of the struggle against racism, not as a specific Jewish thing, because, to go back to what I said earlier, anti-Semitism is actually very little to do with Jews, and it's much more to do with a racist society. Zionism, again, is not really much to do with Jews. It's a political movement, it's a European political movement, and a colonial settler movement. And in all of this, the voice of the Palestinians has been lost, has been suppressed. So I'm very glad that Chris and Abdeen will be here, will be able to give a Palestinian voice to remind us of what has been forgotten in the past 3 years when we've had to fight this defensive battle.
Thank you.